It's definitely a privilege and honor to be here at the podium of the City Opera House tonight and introduce you at this National Writer Series event, one of the stars of American historical fiction, Jeff Shaara. Jeff's first 14 novels, set in various American conflicts, have all made the New York Times bestseller list, and after I finished number 15 yesterday, The Fateful Lightning, which focuses on Sherman's march to the sea in the last months of the American Civil War, I'm sure this one will soon join him on that venerable list. Jeff has brought with him his distinguished friend, Ed Tracy, as guest host tonight, and he will be interviewing Jeff. Now, any Civil War writer, I think, would have been happy to get the freshwater perspective and to write this book this book that is my passport here tonight. However, for me, it went beyond a book, because I meet the people that have read this book. I drive on roads that are named after the people that I wrote about. I have people come up to me that I just know by face to tell me how much they appreciated the exposition of the heroics of their relatives and ancestors. And I have some people just come up to me and play and tell me that they don't think I was quite as stupid as they thought before. And so it's the life on the streets because of this book written in my hometown has been fantastic. I have to tell you that writing this book was an absolute pleasure. I write generally from 6 to 12. I got up every day, and many times I sat down at 6 and all of a sudden it'd be noon and I wondered what happened with the time. And I was curious about that because I really think that during this book, it's my sixth history book, but it was the only one that I actually time traveled. And I bent over to ask at lunch, I had lunch with Jeff today, and I bent over to ask him, do you feel when you're in the midst of your book that you've time traveled occasionally? And he said, oh, of course. So on that note, let me introduce fellow time traveler, Ed Shaara.
Well, thank you, John. That was really, really great. We learned a lot about what happened in the Civil War here. Did they fight anyone here up this far? Did you have a battle in... Why not?
There were probably a few arguments.
Yeah, right. I want to thank Jill Tuesley and Doug Stanton and the City Opera House for hosting this event tonight. You people in Traverse City have the most amazing place here. You should give yourselves a hand. I mean, you've restored this beautiful house. You come here in droves to hear book talks. I mean, it's amazing. I was here last year for Diana's book talk, and I was so honored that Doug asked me back. It is an honor for me to be here with my wife, Denise, who's in the audience, and we just love your city. Thank you very much for asking us. I'm going to just give you an idea of what the format is. We're taping this. You're on film, so that means audience reaction. You can laugh or cry or clap at any time.
No booing.
I thought woo woo. You can woo.
Oh woo. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. We're also taping this for podcasts, so I thought I'd treat this a little bit like a radio show. So at a certain point, I'll just kind of turn away and announce where we are here at the beautiful City Opera House in Traverse City, and speaking with Jeff Shaara, and then I'll give you a little warning. Toward the end, I'll say we'll be taking questions in a little while. So that's the point when you want to be ready to stand up or wave your hand. There'll be a couple of people with the microphones. I'd like you to stand up when the house lights come up. Please announce who you are. Tell us what your name is, and ask your question. And if you ask the question in the form of a question, I guarantee you that Jeff will answer it in the form of an answer, okay? All right, do we have a deal on that one? So that means questions, you know, you can elaborate a little bit, but let's keep it moving right through, shall we? So, the new book is the fourth and final volume in Jeff Shaara's series telling the story of the Civil War in the West. It is the seventh overall on the Civil War, including the Battlefield book that he wrote, which is out there. All of these are for sale out there. The Battlefield book is the only nonfiction book in his collection. It's really superb. This series is 2012, A Blaze of Glory, which told the Shiloh campaign. 2013, A Chain of Thunder, which is the siege of Vicksburg. 2014 is The Smoke at Dawn, Chattanooga. And 2015, today, June 2nd, 2015, is the launch of the new book, The Fearful Lightning, Sherman's March to the Sea, today here in Traverse City. Welcome to Jeff Shaara. Thank you. So, Jeff, we're here. Yes. You're here. I mean, this is the start of a whole month of activity for you.
I have energy.
You do have energy.
That's going to change in about 3 weeks.
Well, no, it won't. I know you for a long time. And this has been a 150-year anniversary each of these years, and you've been on a real pressure cooker to get these books out.
Yeah, and the tour feels like it's going to be probably 150 years by the time I'm through with it. So in all seriousness, I'm happy to be kicking it off here in this format. And the reason for that is when I have a new book come out, you know, it's a new subject, you know, technically. I mean, it's a Civil War, but it's a new area. I have absolutely no idea what I'm going to say in a bookstore to talk about this book. So to start the tour this way is really helpful because it puts all the pressure on you to ask the right questions.
That's right. Yeah, I knew that. That's why I've been studying for months and months and reading all the books. But of course, you have the advantage because you have already released each of the books in the series.
Right.
So you've already been through this with everyone. And of course, everyone here has read all of the books, right? No? Has anyone read all of the books? Okay. So
thank you.
We're going to be telling some of the story of the Civil War. We're going to start with the beginning of the Civil War right to the end in about 20 minutes or
yeah,
so.
Sure.
We're just going to do the whole thing.
Sure.
But right at the top, I did want to talk about that. Can you put into perspective why we fought this war? What was the reason for it in your estimation?
Well, it's unique. Civil Wars are being fought all over the world today. I mean, look at the news. Our Civil War, and one reason people are so interested in it still, 150 years later, it's fought over an idea. And that's, we did a lot of things over ideas in this country, including the American Revolution was fought over an idea. It wasn't fought over booty, over treasure, over land, over spoils, over personalities. I mentioned, I was quoted here, World War I started because of personalities. You can make an argument that there have been a lot of wars like that. We didn't do that. This was a war fought over an idea that holding people in bondage is wrong. And the idea that if you're a state, you are not a part of something greater. You are not a part of the Union. You have the right to do anything you want to. Depending on which side of that you're on, of course, one may be more important than the other. But those were ideas that were unique in the world. Nobody had ever had a controversy like we had in the 1860s.
And obviously everyone was really engaged and involved in this war. 1.1 million casualties, over 600,000 dead.
Yes.
In this war.
Yes, more, which by the way, exceeds the number of American dead in every war we have fought combined. And that's a remarkable
statistic. This is, and it even gets more than that, because in Gettysburg, 160,000, 150,000 combatants
right.
in the Gettysburg battle, 50,000 casualties in 3 days.
Right.
10,000 dead, 10,000 missing.
Exactly.
Which is not a good prospect when you think about missing. So these are very serious stories. I mean, when you look back at the Civil War and you kind of think about it coming from your father's perspective, from Killer Angels, which is a classic, what do you think drove you in that direction from that book?
Well, The Killer Angels, which came out in 1974, written by my father, took him 7 years to write. It's basically the story of the Battle of Gettysburg. He did, after 7 years of obsession with telling that story, the book comes out. wins the Pulitzer Prize for fiction in 1975, and then absolutely bombed commercially. To a writer who everything he does is geared toward making a living from his writing, that was a crushing blow to my father. I mean, he was bitterly disappointed. He had heart disease. He died in 1988 from his second heart attack, died in his sleep, blissfully. 5 years after that, Ted Turner comes along, puts up the money, and The Killer Angels is made into the film Gettysburg. The result of that film, the book becomes a number one bestseller. 5 years, you know, five mm-hmm. years after my father's death. That changed my life in a way I never would have expected. Ted Turner came to me and said, Ted Turner gets very excited. And have whatever opinion you want of Ted Turner. A lot of people have various opinions of Ted Turner, but I am sitting here today because of Ted Turner. He wanted to make more films. He wanted to take my father's book and expand it in both directions because he recognized this is not a documentary about the Battle of Gettysburg. This is not a history book. It's the story of people, and people on both sides. I heard, and maybe many of you have heard, people come out of seeing the film Gettysburg or reading The Killer Angels, and they were struck by the fact that there are no bad guys. This is not John Wayne and the guys in the black hats. You have people on both sides who are decent, honest human beings, who are passionate, men of honor, who are fighting for something they deeply believe in, and that surprised people, that there was no label of, well, this is good, this is bad, you know, the good versus evil. There was none of that. Ted Turner got very excited by that whole idea and came to me, and I had never written anything before, and that's not false modesty, as you know. I mean, I was a dealer in rare coins and precious metals in Tampa, Florida. But I thought about this, and I thought...
Which he still has a lot of, by the way. Yeah. We're trying to work that into the program here a little bit.
Any of you, I'm doing appraisals out in the lobby.
Yeah. It's the roadshow that we're working on together.
But I thought, you know... I wasn't really conscious of the son should follow in the footsteps of the father. I mean, it wasn't anything that noble. But the idea, and the reason I tackled
But that
this,
is exactly how it turned out.
Well, it's certainly how it turned out. But I had no fear, and I get the question a lot, weren't you scared? How did you know how to write a book? I had no idea. The idea was, I'll put a story together that someone else will adapt for a screenplay, and if whatever I come up with is lousy, nobody will ever see it. It'll go in the trash. So there was no fear. Gods and Generals, the script comes together, I write the story, I'm representing my father's estate in New York, Random House now has this number one bestseller, so they take my phone calls, which was kind of mm-hmm. nice, and I'm talking to the publisher, and I said, you know, I told her what I was doing, I'm writing the prequel, Gods and Generals, and she says, oh, why don't you send us the manuscript? Okay, nothing ventured, nothing gained, mm-hmm. send them the manuscript, the phone call I got back, September 1995, the phone call I got, we don't care if it's a movie. We like the book. We think you're a writer. Here's a contract. I said my whole life changed. Yeah, at that, I mean, I remember that day vividly.
And the other side of that is that your father shopped Killer Angels around to 14 or 15 publishers.
15 publishers
could
not get it.
And then it wins the Pulitzer Prize.
Exactly.
So that was 14 books ago. Now, I don't know if you were counting when I started reeling off the number of books that are in this series, but there are seven Civil War books together, but I think you said four books in 5 years or five books in 6 years?
It's five books in 5 years.
Five books in 5 years the last 5 years.
You were close.
And when the last time I sat down with you, which was probably 2006, he said, well, it takes me 18 months to do a book, and you know, so now he's moving it up to 12 months. When are you going to get to six? For Korea, perhaps?
No. Not going, no, I'm going the other way. Okay. No, the five books in 5 years, the fifth of those books was the end of my World War II series, The Final Storm, the last book on the war in the Pacific. And then I immediately went into, because of the calendar. I mean, the sesquicentennial of the Civil War determined what I was going to write and when. We wanted each book to come out in the year of the event. Mm-hmm. And so 2011 had to be the first book, and so I was off and running. Mm-hmm. What I found out is I'm too old to do that.
Yeah.
I wouldn't commit to doing that again. It took mm-hmm. a lot out of me. And I'm not singing the blues up here, I promise you. But it was tough. And so now I am working on Korea, and I've gotten a lot of input from Korean vets, mm-hmm. From people whose parents served in Korea, have said, you know, nobody ever talks about that war. Yeah. Nobody ever tells the story. And there are some fabulous stories. And so I'm excited about that, but I'm looking at 18 months again.
Are you going to go there?
Definitely.
You would go to Korea
definitely.
And do that? Because yes. A lot has been written about Korea, but a lot of people haven't gone there.
I know.
Who have written about Korea.
And the Chosun Reservoir, and the Chosun would certainly be, and those of you who know what the Chosun, the story of the Marines at Chosun, it's a horrible, it's not our best day to be a hero. I mean, there were a lot of heroes, yeah. But I mean, it's a tragedy yeah. of epic proportions for American Marines. Chosun is in the north. You know, you can't mm-hmm. go to Chosun and be a tourist. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's in North Korea.
But
probably,
we'll get you in somehow.
Yeah,
you
know, okay, sure,
we'll
take that chance.
We know a few people.
We'll sneak in.
Yeah, right.
That won't be a problem.
We'll go disguised as someone from Traverse City.
Yeah, right, of course.
Okay, so let's go back. Now, for the benefit of the people that are here, let's go back to third book, to The Smoke at Dawn, and set the stage for what you did through The Smoke of Dawn that sets up the current book.
Well, I had intended, first of all, publishers like trilogies. I don't really know why. I think they can put them in a box, you know. But when I had planned this all along to be a trilogy, Shiloh first, then Vicksburg, then the latest book, Fateful Lightning. And I realized I've just skipped a whole bunch of history. So I went back and looked and went to Random House and said, it's got to be four. And they allowed me to do a four-book trilogy.
Mm-hmm. The first book actually says this is the first
yes,
of
exactly.
three books,
yes.
And then he goes, "Well,
yeah.
there's a fourth book."
So, what happens at Chickamauga, Chattanooga, together? The book starts actually right at the end of the Battle of Chickamauga, because that's another book all by itself. And that's a disaster for the Union. It's a horrible day for the Union Army. William Rosecrans, who's the commanding general, falls completely on his face. It's bad. They retreat to Chattanooga. The Confederate Army under Braxton Bragg has the opportunity of a lifetime to perhaps end the war, to certainly crush the Union Army west of the Appalachians, and they don't do it. Braxton Bragg delays, and that delay and his generals underneath him are going crazy. They see the opportunity in front of them. Bragg won't move, and instead he settles for a siege. Well, the problem is, around if you've ever been to Chattanooga and you see the Tennessee River as it winds around, that's a big chunk of real estate. There aren't enough Confederate soldiers to do the job. They can't close the circle. And eventually, without getting into all the details, but eventually Ulysses Grant arrives to take command. He breaks the siege. He brings the supplies into the starving Union Army in Chattanooga, and then they turn it around. Sherman arrives, which is key to Grant's morale, certainly. George Thomas, another terrific character. Joe Hooker. Those of you who know about the Battle of Chancellorsville, fighting Joe Hooker, the man who loses that battle for the Union, shows up also. He fights the battle on Lookout Mountain, which is an extraordinary story. All of that combined eventually just wipes Braxton Bragg right off the hills around Chattanooga. The one bright spot for the Confederacy, the one shining star, is Patrick Claiborne. Wonderful character, an Irishman who comes over, fights for the Confederacy. He's been called the Stonewall of the West. He's a wonderful character. He's one of the principal voices in that story. But you've got Sherman, you've got Grant, George Thomas. Again, those are the big three for the Union side. And then you've got Claiborne, William Hardy, and Bragg on the Confederate side. It's a tragedy for the Confederacy. Following up, their enormous success at Chickamauga. So all this morale boost in Richmond gets thrown right out the window. Also gets thrown right out the window is Braxton Bragg. Well, that leaves the doorway open to the state of Georgia. Sherman, Grant, meanwhile, goes east. Grant is named by Abraham Lincoln in the spring of 1864 to take command of the entire Union Army. Smartest move Lincoln ever made. Grant goes east, leaving in his place, in his command, he elevates William T. Sherman to command of that entire theater of the war. Sherman recognizes what Grant tells him, certainly, we need Atlanta. Atlanta is the rail hub of the South. All the supplies reaching Robert E. Lee in Virginia are all coming through Atlanta. The state of Georgia has been virtually untouched by the war. The farms, the plantations are prosperous. Let's go get them. Sherman starts that campaign, marches down toward Atlanta, and what takes place then is a series of battles, because the Confederates recognize the value of Atlanta as well, and they fight some pretty pitched battles, but at the end of the day, Sherman's the better general. And Joe Johnston, who is the named command and after Bragg is tossed out, Bragg goes to Richmond and works for Jefferson Davis. Jefferson Davis is good friends with the worst generals in his army, which is one reason the Confederates lost the war. he's loyal to his friends. That's really unfortunate for his army. So Bragg goes to Richmond. In his play, you know, Joe Johnston is now in command of the Confederate Army. Johnston is the master of the strategic tactical retreat. That could be a good thing. And in fact, around Atlanta, it mostly is a good thing, except in the newspapers all across the South. The joke becomes, if we give Johnston enough opportunities, he will retreat his army all the way to Bermuda. Well, Johnston, Jefferson Davis has had enough of that. He hates Joe Johnston. Johnston hates Davis. That's another great way to run an army, have a feud with your generals. And Johnston is booted out. And in his place is put John Bell Hood. Now, John Bell Hood is a tragic figure in many ways. Tragic physically because he loses big pieces of his body throughout the Civil War. He loses three limbs altogether. That's not a good thing. Hood takes command. Well, Hood understands, well, Johnston retreated, I'm going to do the opposite. I'm going to fight, which, of course, sounds good in the newspapers. Hood decides, he's defending the city of Atlanta. Sherman is coming all around him. Hood decides, well, I'm not just going to sit here and defend anything. I'm going to attack. He attacks three times in three separate engagements. What it amounts to is he throws his army away into the guns of Sherman. The result of that is the Confederate forces lose all their strength around Atlanta, and Sherman marches into the city of Atlanta. And this is in the summer of 1864. Hood retreats over to Alabama, tries to figure out what to do next, and decides, well, instead of messing with Atlanta anymore, I've got to redeem myself, so I'm going north. I'm going to go attack Nashville. That's another book, which I didn't write. That's another whole campaign. Sherman's left alone. He owns the city of Atlanta. This book begins, The Fateful Lightning begins, exactly where Sherman decides, okay, I really don't want to sit in Atlanta. I want to go do something else. So that's what we're going to do. He doesn't tell his army. He tells a couple people. Doesn't tell his army where he's going. He tells Grant, what he's planning on doing. But he doesn't tell his people. The best way to keep the enemy from finding out your secrets, don't tell your friends.
Yeah. Well, the Confederates actually didn't really think he was going to keep moving. They thought that he was going to stay and occupy. And Atlanta burns, and Sherman is looking back at the beginning of this book at the burning of Atlanta.
Exactly.
And deciding to do this fateful march. So,
one point I have to make is, if you think about the burning of Atlanta, I mean, think of that scene from Gone with the Wind. You visualize the burn, that incredible Hollywood thing they did with that movie. But Sherman tells the townspeople, the civilians, get out. There's nothing for you to do here. You're in harm's way. I do not want to harm civilians. For the most part, they leave. Some stay. But, I mean, the idea that Sherman butchers anybody never happened. Now, I want to make that
point.
And
he took everything, too. I mean, they were going on the march, so they took all the supplies. Now, this is a big army that's going on march. I mean, are we talking 50,000? 60,000 people. Mm-hmm. And you say in the book that Sherman was fighting the war to end it, and that he felt that his greatest achievement had been planting uncertainty in enemy commanders. Give us a few examples of
those. Well, as Sherman leaves Atlanta, his army is in two wings. They take two routes, and they're heading generally east and south. And along the way, you've got Georgia's, by the way, Georgia's state capital is not Atlanta then, as it is now. It's Milledgeville. Important city in central Georgia. South of Milledgeville is the city of Macon, important city in terms of factories, armaments, and so forth. North, up on the South Carolina border, is the city of Augusta. Three major targets. The Confederacy know, the Confederate people there know that there are three targets. Sherman doesn't let him know where he's going. He makes him think he's going to all three. He literally faints, you know, maneuvers his army in such a way that the Confederate cavalry, and that's all there is, 60,000 Union soldiers, 4,000 Confederate cavalry to stand in their way. So the cavalry's running around in circles trying to figure out where Sherman's going, and Sherman's doing that on purpose, which is brilliant because they can never take, the Confederates can never take all their people and put them in one place where they actually could do some damage to the Union advance. He divides them. He divides them all over the place. The other part of what you said about fighting the war to end it, and this is one reason I think Sherman is perhaps the finest battlefield general we've ever produced in this country. He is so far ahead of his time because he understands the concept of total war. Up until this time, up until the Civil War, if you think about, war is a chivalry, a game of chivalry. It's a gentleman's thing. Think of the British, red uniforms, and you stand up and march in a straight line. I mean, nobody hides behind trees and rocks and runs. No, it's you stand toe-to-toe and you be a man. Well, that works early on in the Civil War. After, you know, about 1864, you can't get enough shovels.
Yeah.
And previously it had been unmanly.
And technology caught up. Bigger
right.
cannonballs, more bullets.
The rifled musket
yeah.
changed all
yeah.
of that. Yeah. And Sherman understands, but even more than that, Sherman understands that in order to win a war, you have to hurt the people who are immune to being hurt. What I mean by that is you've got citizens in Milledgeville, Georgia, you know, there's no men. The men are all off with the army fighting for the Confederacy. You've got the women and children and old people are there in Milledgeville. And Sherman makes the point, you know, he goes into the town and they're like, oh, you know, we're innocent. We didn't, you know, my husband didn't have any choice. He had to go fight. Well, Sherman's not buying any of that. And he realizes, and he communicates this very well, that if it wasn't for you, you people are allowing this war to continue. You are going to hurt. If I don't hurt you, you have no incentive to stop the war. Occasionally you get a boy comes home in a box. Okay, that's sad, you have a funeral. That's, you know, and then some, that's forgotten. No, we have to make it much worse than that. Now, by that, doesn't mean he's gonna just lay waste to the entire state of Georgia, or the march to the sea, the path to Savannah is not a wasteland like some misstated history claims it was. No. He's very selective about what he destroys. First of all, you shoot at him from your house, he burns your house. That's kind of fair, you know?
Yeah.
There are skirmishes where Confederate cavalry will fill up a building in a town, a courthouse. They make it a fortress. And they skirmish with the Union, you know, with the advance as the Union army gets closer, and then they skedaddle and get out of there. He burns the courthouse. You know, he makes it very clear. That, you know, if you make your building, your whatever it is, a target, I will burn it. And he does. And it's extremely effective.
Yeah. So do you have goals for this march? I mean, he had, I know, a certain number of miles each day, 15 miles
15
a day.
Miles per day. That's ambitious.
50,000 people.
60,000 men, 15 miles a day in any kind of weather. And for the most part, they do it. I mean, that's a remarkable achievement right there. These are not good roads we're talking about.
Yeah. Did he know what kind of forces he was going to be up against?
He keeps waiting for the Confederates to show themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, you think about this, he's pushing toward the Atlantic coast. You know, from your perspective, he's pushing this way. And the idea is, well, if there's a bunch of Confederates out here, I'm squeezing them. And eventually, you know, they're going to get squeezed to where they're all in one place, and I'm going to have a pretty good fight on my hands. He keeps waiting for that to happen. He's ready. He's nervous about it. His troops are excited. They're ready to, you know, let's have a fight. There's nobody to fight. The cavalry's out there sort of skirting around, picking at them like mosquitoes. But there's never really an engagement that Sherman, you know, Sherman wants to do exactly what Grant wants to do with Lee. Bring them out in the open. I've got the numbers. I've got the guns. You bring your people out here, I will crush you. That's how the war will end. He keeps waiting for that to happen. Doesn't happen.
The press was getting out too about all of the movement and the cities. I mean, there were areas that were getting burned, and this large group of refugees and freed slaves started to add to this march. And you placed a new character in this book who was part of this group.
Something I have never done before, and I'm really proud of this and very pleased with how it turned out. There is a character in this story. I've only used a civilian once, and that was in the Chain of Thunder, the Vicksburg book, where I use a girl, a 19-year-old Lucy Spence, who's a civilian in Vicksburg, caught trapped just like the rest of the Confederate Army there. And I really got incredible response to that, really positive response. And I had four diaries of women in Vicksburg to draw on as original source material. So I felt pretty comfortable with that. In the case of a slave, there really isn't any source material. I mean, there are no diaries and memoirs and very few collections of letters. And what I did is I created a slave. His name is Franklin, young, 19 years old. His father has lost his leg, and they are slaves on, this is a real place and a real person, the plantation of a guy named Howell Cobb, who was the former governor of Georgia, and he's now a general in the Confederate Army, political general, which means he's worthless. But he's gone from his plantation. Well, as the Union Army presses across Georgia, all the overseers, the foremen on these plantations, the guys with the bullwhips, they leave. You know, they don't want to stick around as Sherman marches through. Well, the slaves they're still on the plantations. They begin to realize we don't have to stay here. And they start to leave and walk away and follow Sherman's army. Now, that's a real interesting phenomenon. There's a bunch of things go on with that. Number one, Sherman's got to feed them. Tens of thousands of them begin to flock behind his army, and Sherman realizes we've got to provide for these people. That's a challenge because Sherman doesn't have, he's living off the land. The other part of it is the freed slaves, most of them, and Franklin is one, are ignorant. They don't know anything about the world. Franklin comes off the plantation having been born and raised there. He's 19 years old. He goes into the first town they come to, and he sees hundreds, if not 1,000 or more, of his people. He had no idea there were that many black people in the world. And he's suddenly seeing them for the first time. Every little observation like that is a brand new experience, a mystery. The Union cavalry is captured a bunch of Confederate money, which is, of course, worthless. They're throwing them out in bundles to this crowd of slaves. Money is just being tossed in the air. And of course, these people are grabbing the stuff out of the air. And Franklin grabs a $100 bill. I was in the rare coin, precious metals, and paper money business. I know what a Confederate $100 bill looks like. I've owned them. I describe it in the book. He's looking at this thing, and there's a vignette where there are slaves bent over in a cotton field. And he's looking at that, realizing he's looking at himself, and wondering why on earth somebody would put that on a piece of their currency.
Or even what the currency was.
Or even what the, well, he has to deal with that, exactly. He still doesn't really understand what the money's for. He's never had any. He's never had a need for it. So he's one by one, these little experiences happen to him, and he begins, the biggest problem, the biggest challenge that he begins to face is that all these freed slaves are euphoric that they are free. They have been delivered. And to use the colloquial term that many of them use, and Sherman hears this many times, they have been rescued by Missa Linkum's boys. That's absolutely accurate. Missa Linkum's boys. And he's hearing this, it's this joyous parade. And Franklin begins to wonder, we're free. What does that mean? And what happens now? We're following the army. We're protected by the army. What if the war ends and the army goes home? And he doesn't even know where home is to these people. What happens then? And that's a question a lot of the people, a lot of the slaves, they're not ready to ask that yet. They're too wrapped up in their euphoria.
Well, they didn't know where slaves went when they ran away, right? They never knew what the other end of the thing. So we're actually looking at this time. We are always looking at history from our very privileged vantage point of all of the people who've written about it before, and we have our own perceptions about it. But this time, this slave is looking at the Sherman March from his perspective, as it's rolling out. He runs forward dramatically and tries to find out what's happening. What does he find out?
And what can he do to help? That he has the wherewithal to realize that these men in blue, this is a good thing. and he sees the cannons, and he sees all the weaponry, and he wants to help because he understands the war is a bad thing.
And he does know how to read. He's read the Bible.
He's been taught by Howell Cobb, who teaches his slaves. And, of course, think about the era. It's all biblical. It's all Sunday school lessons. You know, they have a preacher comes in and teaches them to read the Bible because they're trying to make sure they're good Christians. And so his reading comes from skill with, you know, at reading the Bible. And then also he learns ciphering. You know, he learns how to count to 100, which is, makes it interesting when he sees more than 100 people. What do you call that? You know, he's counted kernels of corn. Now they're people. You know, that's a whole different experience. He knows a little bit about addition and subtraction, you know, like basic ciphering, and that's all he knows. Well, he goes to the camp, this Union captain, who, for Franklin's good luck, the Union captain's a sympathetic man, and he realizes, ooh, maybe we can use this guy as a scout. As, you know, the Union Army's marching basically blind through the countryside. We need to know kind of what the slaves are thinking, what, you know, what's happening on the plantations, rather than just send the scavengers out, which they do, and the scavengers are the people who do the damage in Georgia. That's where Sherman gets his worst reputation, is not from what Sherman did, what his scavengers did. I mean, they burn, you know, piece willy-nilly, that they burn things they never should. They take every single thing that's not bolted down. It's bad. I mean, they're the worst kind of looters. So they're worthless as far as good intelligence, but we can use a man like Franklin, I love the scene where the captain says to him, do you know how to be stupid? And Franklin's first reaction is, you know, to be, oh, they're insulting me, they're making fun of me, and the captain says, no, if you're stupid, you can listen and learn things, because they won't pay any attention to you.
This is what I've been doing most of my life.
Exactly. you were the, this, it,
I
it
was
comes
the model
out, you
for
were
this
the model
character.
For the character.
Yeah.
The other thing, and I love the little piece of this, I referred to this character as Franklin. The captain asked him, is that your first name or last name? He doesn't know. Nobody's ever asked him that before. And he said, well, sir, I guess it's both. And the captain says, no, don't do that. You'll never stop being a joke. You know, you'll be Franklin. It's like, no, you can't do that. I mean,
You keep bringing that back through the book. It's very,
yeah,
it's
and
a
I won't, and actually today piece. When I talked to the class of the students, I told them all of this, and I would not reveal the ending, what his name becomes, and I'm not going to tell you either.
Yeah, you have to read the book. So, who is Clara Davis?
Clara Davis, and Davis is an unfortunate last name. Clara is a slave in the town of Millen. Franklin acts as a scout. He's actually acting as a slave with his master. The master is a fellow named David Cunningham, who's a reporter and from New York, and he's a civilian, and he's in Sherman's camp, and they send him out with Franklin by his side as though he's a southerner and he's escaped his farm and he's taken his slave with him, and they go into the town of Millen, Georgia, to just see what they can find out. When they get there, they find out that the Union cavalry's already there. They're too late. And he goes into a storefront, and in the store, women, no men, and the women take one look at this guy Cunningham and size him up, and he says, well, yes, I've made it through, I've escaped. Turns out, well, actually, the one woman looks at him and says, no. Are you an officer with Mr. Sherman? I mean, it's like they see right through it. And he's talking about, well, I brought my slave. And they're looking at Franklin like, no. So the whole thing just falls apart. But there's a female, there's a girl slave there with the women. And she's sort of sitting on the stairway behind them. And Cunningham has enough of that. And there are a lot of hot words are passed. And Cunningham actually pulls a pistol because it's threatening what's happening. And he says, you know, if you look outside, these slaves are being freed. This army is liberating, you know, these people. And the girl pipes up and says, is that true? And she runs forward and says, you mean I can go with you? And Cunningham says, yes. And of course, the women are just beside themselves, furious, and Cunningham holds the pistol on him. Well, the girl goes with Franklin, out they go, and Cunningham sends them out in the street, get out of here. But they go out in the street, and Cunningham holds the women off, goes back out, and Union cavalry starts coming around because here's a civilian man who is of fighting age. What's he doing here? And Cunningham has his papers, tells him who he is, and they tell him what's been happening. But the point of that story is now Franklin has a mate. And I don't use that term loosely. Franklin has, begins, and he's never been around a woman.
It's a love story.
Ever.
It's a love story in the middle of the Civil War.
Exactly. And, and how they evolve and what she witnesses and how that,
Was that based on anyone? Was the character of Clara based on anyone?
And by the way, she's Clara Davis. In the same reason Franklin doesn't have a last name, that Cunningham asks her, what's your name? And she says, I guess that family's name is Davis. I guess that's my name. And they tell her, no, that's not a good name for you to have. There's Jefferson Davis. You don't. So eventually she, of course, becomes Clara Franklin.
Yeah. So this large mass of refugees and former slaves is an issue for Sherman. And they decide to incorporate this group into the federal forces. And part of that decision was made when Stanton came. You track this meeting between Stanton, Sherman, and a group of former slaves. Talk about that.
Yeah, this is all historically accurate. When Sherman takes Savannah, and he's in the city of Savannah, surprise, Edwin Stanton shows up. The Secretary of War comes down on a boat. Sherman has no idea Stanton's coming down. He doesn't like Stanton. Nobody likes Stanton. He shows up, and there's bureaucrats. He brings a boatload of bureaucrats, and here's all these agency people and stuff from Washington taking charge of this, that, and the other in Savannah. And Sherman realizes, that's kind of a reality of, the civilians are gonna take over now. My job is to march the army, I'll ignore that. But Stanton decides to put together a meeting with Sherman and a number of prominent blacks in Savannah. And if you think about the culture of the time, who are the most prominent people in any town? It's ministers, preachers, the religious leaders. And so he brings in a number, one of whom, Garrison Frazier, is a real person, historically accurate, he's an old man. He is sort of chosen to speak for the group because he's by far the most learned. And they sit around in Sherman's quarters. And Stanton begins to ask questions. This is all in Sherman's memoir, and it's word for word. The questions that Stanton begins to ask them, things like, what do you know of emancipation? And Garrison Frazier stands up and gives him this brilliant answer. And then the questions keep coming like that. Well, nobody's more amazed than Stanton. He's looking wide-eyed disbelief that these Negroes are extremely well-spoken, extremely cognizant of what's going on in this war, something he never expected. And Franklin is right there. He's sitting, he's sort of a part of the meeting. He doesn't say much.
We're seeing it from Franklin's
point of view. And then at one point, Stanton tells Sherman to leave the room. Now Sherman's like, why? It would be a good idea. I want to hear what these people think of you. Sherman is extremely upset by that, and how insulting is that? He gets up, leaves the room, and Stanton asks the gathered, men, what do you think of this guy? And he doesn't want to hear what he hears, which is they're happy. They worship Sherman. They're thrilled at what he's done, and Stanton doesn't want to hear that. He's looking for his own excuses if he can to get rid of Sherman.
Now, I want to ask, is that the part of Sherman's biography that he recreates, because he wasn't in the room to hear that. So how did you gather
Stanton,
that?
Stanton wrote down, Stanton recorded the question.
Okay.
Plus you have, Sherman's staff officers, yeah. And you have Garrison Frazier, uh-huh. Who is, again, a very educated black man, who continues to be a very prominent, probably the most prominent black preacher in the city of Savannah.
Yeah. Well, we're speaking with Jeff Shaara about his new book, The Faithful Lightning, at the National Writers Series in Traverse City, Michigan, at the City Opera House. Thanks, everyone, for being here. There are two Confederate adversaries in the book, William Hardy and James Seeley. Tell us about that.
Well, both of these men, Hardy's a general. Hardy is, both of these men are introduced in the first book of this series at Shiloh, in A Blaze of Glory. Hardy is a West Point I mean, he's a commandant of West Point. He has written the book for the United States Army on infantry tactics and so forth. He knows his stuff. You know, he's a good commander. And he's in command of the state of Georgia and then into South Carolina. He's in command of Savannah when Sherman marches up. Hardee's got maybe 9 or 10,000 men to defend the city of Savannah against 60,000 of Sherman's troops. And Hardee realizes, no, this is not going to work, and he escapes. He builds a pontoon bridge across the Savannah River and escapes and takes his army into South Carolina. That may be Sherman's biggest mistake of the campaign. He allows Hardee to escape. Because Sherman doesn't think he's, I mean, that's an amazing tactic that Hardee just leaves, takes the people and gives Sherman the city of Savannah. The other character is, as you said, James Seeley. James Seeley is a young cavalryman who, in Tennessee, fights for Nathan Bedford Forrest. There's a character. Seeley now comes to Georgia. Forrest is gone. Forrest has a long story there. But he's now fighting for Fighting Joe Wheeler, is the Confederate commander of cavalry. And Seeley, you know, is a cynic. He's a young man. He's got a wife in Memphis. He wants to go home. He realizes, he looks around him, he sees what the Confederates have. It's him. You know, it's his guys. You know, he used to be in command of 300 men. Now he's in command of 50. And, you know, and it's all of that begins to play out. The theme you get from the Confederate side, from both Hardee, who's at the top, and Seeley, who's in the ranks, is one of sort of creeping hopelessness. All the euphoria and optimism coming out of Richmond, still in the newspapers, oh, we're going to throw Sherman into the ocean, you know, the Union Army is starving, you know, all of this propaganda that's being put out of Richmond, here are the guys in the field. They see what's happening. They understand, no, we cannot win this fight, and yet they still have to fight.
So Sherman is marching forward. And he has pontoon boats to go over all of these rivers. He has scavengers out there getting all of these supplies. And he comes onto Savannah, and Savannah's defenseless. So he marches in, and what does he find there? You have a woman who says this, this is one of my favorite lines in the book. A woman in Savannah on the prospect of meeting Sherman says, "I would rather stab myself with a knitting needle, sir." Now, Is that the general opinion of everyone?
Not everyone. I mean, there are the diehard Confederates, very definitely. But one thing about Savannah, and this was also true in New Orleans, if you think about what kind of a city, it's an international city. It's a huge trading hub. You have cotton. I mean, cotton is going out of, before the war. I mean, Savannah is a major source of shipping going to Europe. Shipping coming from the West Indies, and so you've got a lot of people in Savannah who are not Americans. And they're foreigners, and they're caught. You know, they're caught by the Union blockade. They can't leave. And Sherman actually ends up making his headquarters in the house of an Englishman who comes to him and says, "You know, my house is the nicest house in town. Please." And then the Englishman says, "You know, by the way, I own a bunch of cotton. You think you can see your way clear to let me kind of, you know, do business with my customers?" And of course, Sherman understands his customers are English. No, not having any of that. And of course, the Union. These civilian bureaucrats from Washington come down to take the cotton. In the city of Savannah, Sherman finds approximately 30,000 bales of cotton. That's a lot of cotton. That puts a crimp on the Confederate economy, I promise you. Mm-hmm.
And all of these people are now kind of under the Union control, and they're looking forward to what's going to happen next for them. And Sherman's, meanwhile, under some bad news. When he gets some very bad news,
Sherman has lost his son Willie, at 9 years old, died of typhoid fever. Been around the city when he's over in Memphis. And that is Willie is as nine. You imagine being the nine-year-old son of a general. You get to run around the army and play army and all this stuff. And the soldiers love him. They make him an honorary sergeant and all this stuff. Willie dies. And this is a few months before. Sherman then finds out from his wife in Ohio, his infant son, who he has never seen, has now died. He's now lost his second son. The shock of that, well, I don't think I have to explain what the shock of that must be like. It is a crushing moment for Sherman, and he realizes with that much more poignancy, let's end this thing. I want to go home. I want to get this over with. And it gives him even, you know, fresh resolve. Okay, we're not staying in Savannah any more than we're staying in Atlanta. It's time now. And see, here again, the Confederates have no idea what he's going to do. Hardee retreats up to Charleston. Hardee thinks he's coming to Charleston. That's the next logical place for Sherman to go. Huge port on the Atlantic, major city of the Confederacy. Sherman makes Hardee think he's going that way, and then he jukes inland, and he goes right through the center of South Carolina. If you know geography, the center of South Carolina is Columbia, the state capital. That's probably the most controversial thing that Sherman is involved with, is the burning of Columbia. And if you go to Columbia today, you get a very distinct opinion of Sherman. Well, I try to give it to you as accurately, historically, as I can from every perspective, what happens to the city of Columbia.
Is the tour booked in Columbia?
I'm sorry?
Is the tour booked?
No,
in
Columbia? No, I'm doing Atlanta and Jackson, yeah. Mississippi, two yeah. cities that Sherman burned as it is.
Yeah.
I don't
yeah.
need to, you know, tempt fate.
Well, Hardee's, you say that in the book that Sherman outnumbered Hardee's troops 5-1. So wherever he went, Hardee was going to be
right.
done.
Right.
So we're taking questions in a little bit from the audience here, and this is Jeff Shaara, and we'll be taking the questions in just a moment. I wanted to talk about a couple of other things not related, because I think we've kind of worked through the book to the point where I don't want to tell them the whole story.
Right. We're not giving you
We don't
the
want
ending.
To tell them the ending. Okay, we don't want to tell them how it ends.
We don't want to tell you who wins.
Okay, none of that. But did you deal with that kind of issue with every book? I mean, did you? How do you decide where to start, where to end, which battle to choose? How does it happen?
That's an enormous challenge because it depends on the book. Sometimes it's very easy to know where the book's going to end, and this is one example of that. The Last Full Measure, which is the sequel to the Killer Angels, which goes from Gettysburg through Appomattox with Grant and Lee, that was another easy one to know where that book was going to end. And there's structure there, which is very helpful to me. The American Revolution, when I did that two-book set, where do you start? And I actually, the first volume, Rise to Rebellion, I started with the Boston Massacre in 1770. I could have started in 50 different places. At the end of the day, it's about telling a good story. That's what I am a storyteller. I am not a historian. I'm not a chronicler of history. My job is to put the story together historically accurate as I can make it, real people, but make it a good story. And so that's the challenge, is finding where do you begin so that you don't have 200 pages of putting people to sleep, you know, before you get to the good stuff. But you don't also blow all the, you know, all the mystery in the first five chapters.
Well, it has to be real, and it has to be right. And that's a real challenge for a storyteller like you, because of historical fiction, there are a lot of people out there that have opinions. I'm sure that people stand up all the time and say, why did you say that about Sherman or Grant? What's one of those examples from something in the past? Just so that we can dampen the enthusiasm here.
Wow, there are so many. I mean, I've had people stand up and say, advocates of George Thomas, people who are big pro-George Thomas people, they hate Grant because Grant was Thomas's superior. They don't get along. I paint that picture from Grant's point of view in the Chattanooga book, and I got grief. Oh, George Thomas, he was the finest general in American history, the Rock of Chickamauga. Well, yeah, okay. But he wasn't a very, he was slow, and he was sluggish, and Sherman in particular has no patience for that. He's a good defensive general, which sometimes you need that, but you don't need it when your commanding officer is telling you to do something, and you sort of sit on your hands, and Thomas does some of that, and if you love George Thomas, I'm sorry, but this is what happens. But no, I mean, I get that kind of grief. I also get the opposite of that. You talk about a polarizing character. How about Nathan Bedford Forrest? This is the man who founds the Ku Klux Klan. Now, during the Civil War, he's probably, along with Jeb Stuart on the Confederate side, the finest cavalryman of the war. I mean, he creates havoc for the Union wherever he goes. He's a top-notch fighter. After the war, kind of unfortunate. Well, I've had people get in my face. How can you portray this man, given what he did? The story I'm telling you happened before he did what he did. And it's a legitimate story. It's a good story. He's a good soldier. And, you know, I can't tell history in hindsight. If you start doing or using modern standards, and I'll give you another one. I had a reviewer say, I don't understand how this man can paint a positive portrait of George Washington because he owns slaves. I'm sorry, but in 1760, a whole bunch of people owned slaves, and it was not a controversial issue. It was the culture we lived in. And we can look back and pass judgment on that culture. That's fine. I agree with that judgment. But we can't take these characters out of context and condemn them for what they did for living in their time. And that's my job, is to take you with me back to the time of these characters and show you their world, the world they lived in. One of the shocks for Franklin is that he discovers not all these guys in blue are his friend. You know, at Ebenezer Creek, Georgia, there is a terrible thing that happens. I won't tell you what it is, but a lot of these freed slaves who are marching behind the army, some of them say, you know what, I'm going back home. You know, this is not what I thought it was going to be. That's a shock to a lot of people, to a lot of the slaves, certainly, that these guys in blue are not all nice guys, and they're not all heroes. And that kind of reality is a surprise to people because it's too easy. You take that one paragraph about Sherman's march to the sea you learned in high school, that doesn't quite tell you the story. That's my job.
A lot of people moving all at once. A lot of moving parts in the Civil War. Your father had a review, and someone said that. Let me get this exactly right. That he. I'm missing this one a little bit. I was right on it for a second. Let's go on to your dad just for a second. He started this concept of meeting into. Now I know what I was going to say. He started this. Hey, you know, I'm getting old, folks. I'm sorry. He started this concept of living within a character, right. And the review said that the reviewer asked him, "Are you ever visited by all of these characters that you have written about?" And he said, yes, I am, all the time.
Yeah.
And I have to think with 15 books on various combat actions, you must have a lot of company in that house.
The problem with saying what my father said to a newspaper reporter is when you see it in print, it looks like Michael Shaara is a schizophrenic. However, now I know exactly what he meant. And yeah, it's not that my house is filled with ghosts, although maybe it is, I don't know. But I live in Gettysburg after all. But you have to get, I have to get to the point. Someone said to me, and maybe you've heard me say this already, how dare you put words in the mouth of Robert E. Lee? Okay, if I accept that challenge, I better make sure those words are accurate to the character. The only way I can do that is if I hear the voice. And the only way to hear the voice is to hear the words as they are, as you know, as we have them today. Diaries, memoirs, collections of letters. The accounts of the people who were there. I mean, Robert E. Lee never wrote a memoir, but people around him did. You know, Sherman's memoir, Grant's memoir, Joe Johnston's memoir. I mean, go on and on and on. I mean, there are fabulous sources. You can't just take one. And take that guy's word for Longstreet's a great example of that. Longstreet's memoir, he writes it 30 years after the war, takes all the credit for everything, because anybody who can disagree with him is dead. But if you sort of parse them together, you can begin, this is my process, I can begin in the research to get a feel, as though I know the character. And when I'm writing, because I get this question a lot, how do you write the dialogue? All I'm doing, and again, I don't want to sound schizophrenic, all I'm doing is I'm sitting in the room and I'm telling you what I hear. I'm listening to the conversation and I'm just writing it down. And that's very much what the process is like. And I have to get to that point before I can ever begin writing.
Did you dissect Killer Angels?
No. I read it before I began working on Gods and Generals. I have not read it since. First of all, I never want to be accused of copying anything my father did. The one thing, the one thing I have copied all the way through all of my books is the format my father invented, which is to go back and forth between the characters, to move you through the timeline by going back and forth from different perspectives. So sometimes you're seeing the same event from two sets of eyes, which gives you two very different perspectives. That makes the story, first of all, makes it fun. It makes it a little more interesting, and again, it's not a history lesson.
You hear about it at the end of one, and then the next character is talking about it happening as it's happening. It's really fascinating. It's a fascinating way to learn history. It's a fascinating way to get excited about history. And I know you speak to classes all the time. You do a lot of charitable work. You have been on the Civil War Preservation Trust for a number of years. And this is a topic that's coming up now. It's coming up for refunding in September. Talk about the preservation effort.
Well, first of all, one of the reasons I wrote my book on the battlefields, my nonfiction book, is a fundraiser. All the royalties from that go right back to battlefield preservation. I say that in the introduction.
Your only nonfiction book.
Right, the only nonfiction book. I did that on purpose. I wrote that book. I picked the 10 sites not for historical importance as much as preservation importance. These are the sites that are in the best state of preservation, where you can go, take your family, a family on their summer vacation drives past a sign that says Shiloh National Military Park. Why should we stop? Here's why. You know, I tell you what happened there, why it's important, and then I tell you what you can see today that you're not going to get from the typical Park Service, boring guidebook. I'll give you one real quick example. There is a cannon. There are a lot of cannons at Shiloh, just like there are everywhere at Gettysburg. There is a cannon facing the Tennessee River, and I can't tell you which one it is because there's plenty of them. You can reach your hand. It takes an adult to do this. Reach your hand down the barrel. It takes a certain amount of courage to do that. Reach your hand down the barrel. You can feel the ball. It's still loaded. That's cool. I asked the park ranger if I could fire it. They weren't having any of that. kind of thing.
There was an event in 1964 to a family vacation that started this all out. And so I want to, before we take Q&A, I want to talk about that particular event and the importance that it is to a young boy with his father at Gettysburg.
We have film of a 12-year-old boy climbing all over cannons, because that's what 12-year-old boys do. That 12-year-old boy was me. And we went there. We'd been to those of you old enough to remember, the New York World's Fair. We'd been to the New York World's Fair, and we're driving back down to Tallahassee and took the Blue Ridge Parkway. Oh, what a dismal drive that was. All due respects to the Blue Ridge Parkway people.
They're all writing now. Yeah, I can hear them calling in.
Yeah. But we went to Gettysburg for me. I was the Civil War kid. I was the kid with the little soldiers and would stage these elaborate battles on the floor of my bedroom. And my father knew this. He had no interest in history, none. We went to Gettysburg as tourists, as millions of people do every year. We went there and something happened to my father. He was a storyteller. He was a sci-fi writer. He'd written police drama, all kinds of things. He'd never written anything historical, and he realized, he knew a good story when he saw one. And he realized at Gettysburg there was a good story. We're walking across Pickett's Charge. Many of you perhaps have done this. If you go to Gettysburg, it's about a mile across an open field. This is the path the Confederate soldiers took going up against the guns of the Union at the top of the hill, and it's Pickett's Charge on July 3rd, 1863. It's an absolute catastrophe, not just for Confederates, but for humanity. We're making the walk. My father is telling me the story as we're going across. The story that he's telling is not the history lesson. It's the story of Winfield Hancock, the Union general who's up there in command, and Lewis Armistead, his best friend, who's a Virginian, who goes south at the beginning of the war, who's leading a brigade of troops across that field right into the guns of his best friend. And he's telling me this story, and we're walking, as we're walking across the field, we come up the hill, we get to the Union line, which is a low, rocky wall. We step over the wall, just as many of Armistead's soldiers stepped over the wall, as Armistead himself did. We're walking up, and he's telling me this story with an incredible amount of passion and drama to it. There's a little concrete marker about 20 yards up the hill, about that big. And sticking out of the ground next to the marker is a Confederate flag. Well, we're on the Union side now. What's the deal? My father didn't know. We walked up, he turned around, he looked at it. It is the place where Armistead fell. It's as far as he got. My father began to weep. I'm 12. I've never seen my old man cry. And I realize now, at that moment, he was Armistead. He was telling me that story from Armistead's eyes, and he writes it in The Killer Angels from Armistead's eyes. And that moment has stayed with me in the many years since, and that's what I try to do in every book that I write, is to have that moment with every character that I portray. Thanks, Dad.
Yeah. And I think it's safe to say that if he was here right now, he would say that you've done a pretty good job there on these 15 best-selling books. The new book is The Fateful Lightning. And I have one last comment. It did not go unnoticed to me that the opening quote on the first page of Killer Angels is, "Mine eyes have seen the glory." And the title of your seventh book in this Civil War series is The Fateful Lightning, which is the next refrain of the Battle Hymn of the Republic. And I don't know if that was intentional or not. Well, then we found something that no one else will ever know. I'm so glad that I found that out by myself.
You did.
The Fateful Lightning, Jeff Shaara. So we're going to take some questions now. Thank you for being patient and so studious here today. We got one over here on the right side.
Am I on? Can you briefly talk about when Joe Johnson was surrendering to Sherman and Lincoln was assassinated? What were your feelings? What was happening on the battlefield? Two armies were mingling together. What do you have to say about that?
You're asking me to give away a big chunk of the ending of the book. No, I mean, in all seriousness, if you think about what's happening with the end of the war, simultaneously, Lincoln is assassinated. Now, from the North's point of view, obviously, this is an absolute tragedy of monstrous proportions. As Joe Johnston recognizes, it's also a tragedy for the Confederacy, because he recognizes, as do a lot of politicians, that Lincoln is looking for reconciliation. Lincoln, you know, the whole issue of Reconstruction, which is a nasty business, would not have happened had Lincoln lived. Johnston sees that before it happens. He sees this is the worst thing that could happen to the Confederacy, because now there will be revenge. You know, now every Confederate will be seen as complicit in the murder of Abraham Lincoln. And, you know, that's a point. I think it's easy to see what the sentiment is in the North. I mean, it's the worst tragedy ever in this country, but it's also a tragedy in the South. And I go into that in quite a bit of detail.
On the back here.
First, Jeff, as a tribute to your father, I taught Killer Angels for 16 years in high school in Cadillac, and probably had 1,000 kids who fell in love with the Civil War due to your father.
Nice. Thank
so
you.
That's neat. My question is, you're turning out a book a year. I don't see how you can do the research. Do you have a team of research people?
I get that question a lot, because the assumption is, and I get actually grad students sending me resumes. They want to work for me, which is a really nice thing. And I tell them, no, if you think about the nature of the research that I'm doing, what I talked about before, getting into the heads of the characters and getting to know them personally, I can't send a grad student out and say, go find out what Sherman's like and come back and tell me. It doesn't work. I mean, I have to do that myself. I do all the research myself. I typically read 40 to 60 books for every book that I write. I mean, that's and it's 7 days a week. And in that year that I sort of carved out with the calendar, it was 6 months of research, 6 months of writing. And again, when I say 6 months, I mean virtually every day. And yeah, it is pretty intense.
Over on this side.
Two quick questions. General Hancock is portrayed by both you and your father as one of the brightest and bravest of Union generals. How, and I'm sure it's quite accurate, how do you sense that he was overlooked when so many of the other idiot Union generals were promoted? And the second question is, when you were at Gettysburg, did you sense the ghosts that are there?
There's a good way to answer the second part of your question. But first of all, as for Hancock, you got to remember, rank has a lot to do with it in the U.S. Army. You know, Hancock does not, I mean, he comes to the Army. He's a captain. He's a quartermaster in Los Angeles when the war breaks out, the little post of Los Angeles. He's a one-man quartermaster. And, you know, so when he comes to Washington to fight, he's not going to be made, you know, commander of anything, and he has to sort of work his way up. Or there's people, you know, McClellan and all these other people that are already ranking. So there's that. The other part of it is, after Gettysburg, or at Gettysburg, Hancock is wounded, severely wounded. He takes shrapnel from his own wooden saddle up into his groin. Yeah, that'll make you cringe. And they can't get all the splinters out. He is in agony for the last half of the war. Well, he takes himself out of the game. I mean, he goes to Grant and resigns because he just can't do it. He can't ride a horse. He can't do it anymore, which is one reason right there that he doesn't, you know, George Gordon Meade keeps his job after Gettysburg. You have a number of others, but clearly Hancock was one of the stars for the Union Army, and it was because of that wound that you don't hear more about him late in the war. I'm going to do exactly what you just did now. Blank on the second part. Oh, the ghost. Oh,
ghost.
Yeah, right.
Ghost. It happens.
Yeah. What you have mentioned, without really meaning to mention it, is a huge part of my research, which is not ghost hunting. It's walking the ground, going to where all this stuff happened, whether it's a battlefield, whether it's the soldier's home, his grave. I've mentioned to the students this afternoon, if I'm going to describe, imagine it's the kid with the bayonet and he's going running up the hill into the guns of the enemy. It's really better if I've run up that hill than just seen a picture of it in a book. And so in every book I've done, save one, I have been there. I've been to the ground. And it's not just the ghosts. There's something else, and I can't really describe it. It's crucial. And it's the lesson I learned from my father, making that walk across Pickett's Charge. The one book I couldn't do, the book The Rising Tide is the first of my trilogy, World War II in Europe. The Rising Tide takes place in North Africa and Sicily. I wanted to go to the Libyan desert. You know what's in the Libyan desert? All that stuff that Rommel had, the tanks, the artillery pieces, the trucks, it's the desert. Nothing happens to it. It's all still there. All the stuff blown up, the wreckage. How cool would that be to go see all of that? The State Department actually said to me, we really don't think it's a good idea for an American to go wandering around in the Libyan desert. They don't especially like us in that part of the world. And so that's the only place I have not been able to go. But you know, you mentioned Korea. I mean, yeah, I'll go to Korea, you bet.
Yep. We're going to have some time to do both of those. So we'll get a bus trip. We have one over up here in the back, and then we'll go to the center over here, and then there.
Thanks for coming, Jeff. My name is Tom Mayer. Can you go back to coins? Do you have a coin story that maybe relates to war, the Civil War, a favorite coin?
Well, that's kind of a tough one. I will say this: the answer, you know, I'm out of the coin business. I sold my company. I still play around. I have friends who are still in the business. And I get a call every now and then from a friend of my mother's or something that, you know, somebody's died, they need a coin collection appraised. And that's fun. I mean, I enjoy doing it. I don't have to make a living at it anymore, which is which is really nice. But the only coin thing I will tell you is I was in Charleston at the Hunley Museum. The Hunley, the Confederate submarine, I mean, a remarkable story. They talk about a book. And they were still in the process of restoring this. I had a behind-the-scenes tour. This thing, I mean, the archaeology work that was going on was incredible. Anyway, the captain of the Hunley had in his pocket a $20 gold piece that at a previous battle had stopped a bullet. Now, that sounds like something Hollywood would come up with. I've held the coin in my hand. It's probably worth in excess of $1 million. They allowed me to hold the coin. There's the bullet. I mean, it's there. That's pretty cool. That's to be able to touch a piece of history like that was a very special thing. I don't take that for granted, but that's about it for me in the coin.
We have one in the middle. I think we have one time for one more?
Yeah, one more.
One more question. I'm sorry.
I'll be happy. By the way, I'll be happy to answer questions out when we do the book signing.
Yeah.
Mechanically, what steps do you go through? I mean, you alluded to reading 40 to 60 books, doing a vast amount of research, walking in the places where these battles took place. But mechanically, just take us through the steps that you go through to get from that great body of research you do to the final product, I've read everything that you have written, and it's all good, in my opinion. To get to that point,
you'll get your $5 after.
Yeah.
One of the challenges is when to stop researching, because particularly Civil War and World War II, you talk about an embarrassment of riches. I mean, we've got memoirs. Good Lord! I mean, I could be reading for the rest of my life, and that is a challenge to know when to stop. When I feel as though I can sit down, and one thing I don't do, I told the class this today. I don't research and then write, and research and write. That would drive me insane. I do all the research first. The story has to be here before I can begin to put it on paper. Now, things happen, and the story will suddenly go this way. I didn't expect that, but the research is all behind me. It's all done. I take notes. I make all kinds of notes. But to get to the point where, there's no other way to put it, to get to the point where I'm ready, because once I sit down and start writing, I don't stop. And again, the seven-day thing, and I'm not trying to build myself up into something. That's just the way it is. I liken it to a faucet turning on. When the faucet turns on, let it run. Don't stop it. Let it, and every now and then it stops itself. I'll wake up one morning, it's like, I'm going fishing, and I'll do that. But, once out of every 15 days or something, I'll have a day like that. But the rest of the time, it's every day. And it is very much like a faucet running. So there's no clear answer to your question except, and I hate to use this word, it's part of the magic. It's part of the magic of writing to me. And maybe any of you who are writers out there, and I don't, you know this, it's different for everybody. But that's the way it is for me, and that's the way it feels. And those days when you write something and I'll start at 10 o'clock in the morning and I'm flying, I'm one of these typists. I type 50 words a minute with two fingers, and I'm going like crazy, and I look up, and it's dark outside, and the whole day has gone, and I don't know what time it is, I haven't eaten anything, I'm exhausted, but that's magic when that happens, and to read it the next day, and go back to fix it and clean it up, and read stuff that I don't remember writing, that's fun. That's why I'm a writer. No. Thank you.
So it's number 15, and it is the last Civil War book for now, because there's lots of other stories, and I don't believe for a minute that Jeff Shaara is not going to write another book about the Civil War. But this is number 15, The Fateful Lightning, and it was released today, June 2nd, 2015, and you, here in Traverse City, are the first ones to hear it, see it, and feel it from my friend, Jeff Shaara.
Thank you.